manually.
Bringing the meeting to order. Approve some minutes. Mary Ellen, which one are we actually approving?
The 13th and the 23rd.
Okay. Let's see, was I here then?
Motion?
I move.
John?
Okay.
No second.
You okay with that, Fred?
Yes, okay.
Okay, scheduled appointment, 7 o'clock. Dan Nietzsche, maybe?
That's correct.
Okay.
We have to sign each one?
Oh, yeah, I thought it was just the top.
Man is Superman. Okay, MACC, you're on.
Excellent, thanks for having me again this evening. I don't know if you, I kind of gave my spiel last time.
Yeah.
Don't know where you want me to leave off.
I'm okay with it.
Great.
You guys okay with it?
I read, I did some questions, maybe you can answer them, I didn't see them in here. If there's more than one, like a disaster, emergency, or whatever, how do you decide which one to address it?
Address them all. So if you had multiple disasters going on at the same time, let's say you had a hurricane and a, it was coming up the Connecticut River Valley, and there was a...
Hurricane in more than one town, say.
Plague.
Two or three towns, how do you know, how would you decide?
How would you decide which town to work with?
Yeah.
You'd work with all of them. So every town that wanted to reach out to the MAC for assistance would receive assistance.
So my inhibition about this was, uh-oh, here we go, we might get caught up and we get a service for free, grants, whatever. And then a year, 2 years later, oh, the grants are dried up, now we got to pay for it. But we have a 60-day advance notice and we can get out, right?
That's correct.
I like that.
Yeah.
And evidently, the town emergency people like it also, the service, I'm told, I've been briefed.
Great.
So I'll be brief. It seems like we can't really lose too much on this, and if it gets expensive, we can bail.
That's correct.
Yeah, but there is expense to the town if we get mutual aid or whatever, call it, from other agencies. The town is liable to pay that, right?
Depends on where you get it from and what the terms of that agreement are. So the MAC MOU amongst the towns within Franklin County that entered into it, there is a reimbursement portion of it, but the sticking point is you have to have a supplemental agreement at the time of request. The MOU is not that supplemental agreement. So if you say to Greenfield, if you say to Greenfield, I need 2 backhoes, right? And Greenfield says, fine, you can have them, they're yours, free, whatever, go ahead and use them. That's great. If Greenfield turns around and says, we'll give you 2 backhoes, they're $100 an hour per unit, you'll have to work out some sort of supplemental agreement at that time.
That mutual aid has nothing to do with the MAC agreement, but I mean, you have those agreements regardless.
Right. Then, I mean, there's a highway mutual aid agreement.
Right.
There's fire mutual aid.
Sure.
This, the mutual aid that's listed in here is the statewide mutual aid law. It's a little different.
So I mean, even if there was some calamity that affected us and other contiguous towns, the cost we did incur dealing with whatever it is would probably be whatever they were, regardless of whether you guys exist or not.
That's correct.
So, well, and if it's that big a deal, there's going to be state aid coming in, you're going to have...
Eventually.
I mean, it just...
Yeah.
And one of the great things about the MAC is with that state aid, I mean, I've seen it, towns get quickly overwhelmed with the amount of paperwork recording what you've received and sent out. The MAC can certainly help you to keep track of that so that the aid can come back quickly.
Well, as Brian is learning, probably very small town with lots of paperwork. You get the same amount of paperwork if you have 1 million people or 1,000, so maybe we should grow our population, make more efficient.
I've seen the largest municipalities in the state become quickly overwhelmed with paperwork after an emergency. It's quite amazing the amount of paperwork needed.
Well, there's straight more. pages.
Oh, there's eight more. God. Probably this must be a
statement. 2 years ago, 3 years ago,
speaking of paperwork,
we had a series of ice storms, etc. Mm-hmm. There were reports of lack of communication with what was then WMECO. Now whatever it's called.
Eversource.
Where trucks were in one place not doing anything because where they were didn't have a problem. And where they weren't had all the problems in terms of power outages and whatnot. Would the MAC get involved with coordination of non-government resources, such as utility trucks working with us to call in assistance from other states if we needed help getting power back up and whatnot, or is it mostly coordination of government operations?
You're starting to get into Department of Public Utilities kind of area of operation.
But it's still emergency management, there is no question.
There is. So how I can see the MAC helping out is addressing all the needs of the towns that are being affected, presenting that information to MEMA, where DPU has a seat within their EOC, and relaying that information to there. The MAC's not going to have any command and control responsibilities to be able to call in.
But the MAC would have a sense of what was going on in each town, in theory. So if there was an ice storm and it was 2 o'clock in the morning, you would have a sense of what towns had what power outages, and you could be coordinating with the public utility to get their data.
Exactly. And actually, it's very simple now. DPU has an online application that shows power outages up to the minute. Every 2 minutes, it shows every power outage in the state, right down to the street level. So that kind of situational awareness is open to everybody now, which is great.
I see also, it just comes to my attention, reading through my file here, Lynn Sibley, our emergency management director, says we feel that the MAC will supply vital support for the initial 72 hours of an incident, and we encourage the select board to adopt the MAC agreement. So.
Why 72 hours? Is that all it?
For the initial 72 hours. I don't know. She didn't say, but.
Is there some magic number of reason for 72 hours?
I believe that's the amount of hours that FEMA gives, saying that they're not going to be able to respond to a community for 72 hours. Everybody needs to be prepared for 72 hours.
Okay.
So the MAC would kind of fill that role to start doing what needs to be done.
In coordination with the towns.
Of course. Yeah, the MAC's not going to be doing anything on its own. All direction from the member towns.
Okay.
It's really an administrative asset.
So are we ready to issue
anything else? Sort of all
we're good. You're good, Fred?
Yes.
Okay. Let's sign whatever.
You should sign that.
Have all towns signed?
Just the chairman needs to sign that.
There's four towns that declined.
What was the four towns?
Public information.
So. No. I'm trying to, I don't want to mess that up on the list. Charlemont, Leiden, Warwick, and it's escaping me the fourth one. The one next to Warwick.
Leverett?
Yes. Those four towns.
And why? What was there?
I know Charlemont feels that it would add another level of bureaucracy, that they feel comfortable working directly with MEMA, and they feel they can handle their own emergencies without any assistance. Leiden, kind of the same thing, heard that they can handle everything on their own. They're not worried about needing any assistance. The other two just flat out said we're not interested. No reason given.
Okay. All right.
Okay. We're good.
We're good.
Regionalization continues.
Good. Thank you, Dan.
Thank you. Have a great night.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, next on the agenda, 7:30. We're running a little early, but that's okay.
Well, but is there anybody, there's nobody from the district here, though, so. So, probably.
So maybe we should move on.
Yeah.
Is Keith here? I don't see him. Okay. Let's see. We could have a public comment. Is there any public comment for next time? You guys don't think that.
Just a quick one. And Brian's been, is totally in the loop on this. I've been working with Chris Collins, the FCAT director, trying to get us cabled up, working with Comcast. On August 3rd, and like I say, everybody's in the loop on this. The outfit that did Deerfield's cabling is going to come in here, take a look at us, give us an estimate. We are going to ideally get Deerfield's old cameras. And then whatever equipment they left, but we'll still need to buy a little bit of equipment. And then from that point, it'll be, of course, up to the select board from that point. And according, the final version of the Comcast contract is in front of Comcast, which is like a year and a half later. So we're waiting for that to get the drop.
Is our cable, is our FCAT committee for Whately in the loop on this?
Yes.
They are.
Well, in the loop on the...
Part of the discussions, what we need, what our needs are.
I have no idea about that. They're in the loop on the contract, and not through me.
Who's doing this arrangement?
Myself, Chris Collins, and he's now talked to this Bill Mincer, who just did Deerfields.
So you're volunteering this?
Effort. Yes. We have been for quite some time. Uh-huh. Trying to get we're waiting for the contract, which has been just merciless.
Why is we being the town?
Yes. Huh. And that is what our cable committee, as far as I know, is working on, is the contract.
But we're going to get a permanent owner of Deerfield cameras, et cetera.
Right.
They should be involved with that as well.
If they are, it'd be through Chris Collins. We've heard nothing.
So is Chris spearheading that? I'm confused.
Who's our FCAT committee? Who's on it?
I would imagine Joyce still is.
Joyce is. So Joyce is aware of all that's going on?
I would think Joyce is aware through Chris Collins.
We had I talked to Joyce Palmer Fortune about this. Because this seems very loosey-goosey to me.
Yeah, they came, 6-9 months ago, wanted us to commit money for their capital program whatever.
That's gone.
We committed money, and now it's taking them forever to get us hooked up. I think...
Well, we didn't commit any money.
We didn't give them any money?
No, we told them no money. And now they're moving to Sunderland. That whole deal's pretty much gone.
I mean, who told what no money? I don't understand.
Well, we didn't give them any money.
We, you guys.
We agreed to give them, was it 1/4 or something of our capital budget for FCAP.
We were going to wait to see my understanding is we're going to wait to see what it costs us to cable up and then see what we would give them. But now that whole deal is gone. They're not looking for a building anymore.
That's when they were looking for a building. Yes, that supported the concept of them getting a building. Once the costs were established, then they didn't say anything about getting
the They couldn't get enough money to do a building.
They wanted, okay.
And right now they're negotiating with Sunderland.
For what, office space?
In the town hall.
Oh.
Well.
So are we moving ahead to get this building online? Or are we just waiting for other people to...
Well, we're dead in the water until the contract's signed. But on August 3rd, the company that installs this stuff and just did Deerfields is coming in to look at us and give us a quote. And Chris Collins has offered and I don't know about the loaner. We haven't worked that out. He just says the Deerfield equipment is available. They just spent $60,000 putting in high def cameras and took out their old ones. And he said, we don't need high def here.
So you'll be involved in that meeting on August 3rd?
Right. I plan to be. And Brian.
Our cable committee, whatever, as well.
I have not talked to the cable committee.
They've got to be involved.
I mean, they're more than welcome to be involved. I'm not. I've been dealing with Chris Collins, who's, as far as I know, I have no idea. All I know is the cable committee in Joyce specifically is working on the contracts because nothing was happening.
Right. So the contract is waiting to be signed at their end.
Comcast now has the final wording. And it's taken, I think, over a year now to get it to that point.
Okay. So we'll get a report back after this meeting, August 3rd.
Can you reach out to Joyce or whoever? Okay. Yeah.
So we're not on Comcast until we go live here, right? All this video is just through FCAT.
Correct.
And posting on YouTube. So are we paying Comcast fees right now?
No. Comcast pays us. That's what we're waiting on the contract, and we'll get a lump sum of money. That's where our $46,000 has come from that's going to pay for the part of the cameras. We already have it in the bank.
But Chris shouldn't be making these decisions.
He's not making any decisions. He's just helping us get a quote on the building.
Right, but he shouldn't be making this. Well, okay.
Yeah, he plans to come, was my understanding, before you guys, once he gets the information.
Right, he's not making any decision. Right.
We need the FCAT committee for Whately to really engage with this because that's why they exist.
Right.
Well, do you want Brian to attend the meeting on August 3rd?
Sure.
Okay.
Yeah, and it has to have somebody from FCAT here.
Okay.
I mean, so the timing has to be where one or more of them are available. Yeah. I mean, again, I don't know who's on that committee these days. We just did the.
I'm not sure about the third person.
So see, this is all stemming from us trying to get the drop out of Comcast.
So who's going to pay for all this, whatever they decide on August 3rd? Who's paying for all the connections and all that?
We are.
Through Comcast's money.
That's right.
But then the question is going to be, I'm going to simplify the numbers. Let's say Comcast gives us $5, and this arrangement ends up costing $4. That leaves the town only $1 out of its cable access reserves to do all the other stuff that cable access has to do. So we need to be aware of how much money is going to be left in our budget.
Well, yeah, I would assume that the FCAT committee is.
I would hope so. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right. Any other public comment? Thank you, Dan. Why don't we go to Brian for the update?
Okay, a couple things. We'll get to other things later. The invitation for grant quotes for the Center Cemetery stone restoration is out. Bids are due August 12th. Again, that was $30,000 of CPA money to do this stone restoration in the Center Cemetery. The Town Hall request for qualifications. It was a site visit on July 14th. There were 10 different firms in attendance at that time. And as a reminder, the responses to the RFQ are due on Friday, are due on July 28th. It's Thursday or Friday of this week. Town Hall painting, the request for written responses that's required, that's going to be released August 3rd. Again, that's painting the rear of the Town Hall. This is for the procurement. Responses will be due tentatively August 19th. August 3rd, because we have notification requirements. And in terms of the complete streets policy, that's still pending review with MassDOT.
Okay, that's it?
That's it.
Wow.
Right. It's still pending review from what?
Through MassDOT.
Okay.
So, yeah, I checked this afternoon.
Okay, so we're still waiting for Keith. And actually, we could go into, we're still waiting for somebody from that.
New business
district. Yeah, gasoline bid.
Gasoline bids. This was try number two for the gasoline bids, and we got two bids. They were F.L. Roberts with a price of 52 cents over markup, so that's how they were put out. There's the Boston little tank car price, so we asked the companies to say what the markup will be. F.L. Roberts was 52 cents. Sandry Energy was 60 cent markup. So the little bidder was F.L. Roberts, the gasoline bid. So that would be our recommendation that the award would go to F.L. Roberts. It's a little bidder.
All right. Okay. You guys good with that?
Yeah, fine.
All right. Highway police fire phone system, Comcast or MBI connection.
All right. So I believe at the end of June, we authorized Crocker to continue the installation of the voice over IP phone systems in the remaining town buildings. It's okay, so that requires an internet connection. There's an existing Comcast connection at the police station. There's no internet connections at the highway building or the fire station. So there's also, so that's one option is to go through Comcast and at the fire station as well. There's an MDI drop in the fiber there. The phone network should function fine over Comcast, mm-hmm. over the Comcast lines. So I guess what we need internet access in those buildings to complete that. So we'd be looking for authorization to open up internet accounts at the fire station and the highway building.
Okay. Sounds reasonable.
Isn't the fire station emergency management location or whatever you want to call it? So don't they have some kind of internet service? How do they connect with
police station?
Police station.
Police station.
The police station is the emergency management
yeah.
center or whatever. Okay.
Having a little bit of understanding of voice over IP in multiple locations, not an exhaustive amount, mind you.
Yeah.
We are one entity. When you have multiple locations for a business and you do voice over IP, there is an incremental cost when you add phone lines in those satellite locations. But as I'm reading this, the cost is not virtually independent of each building. It's a group buy. You're getting economies of scale. It doesn't strike me that we're getting economies of scale through Comcast. And so if we're not, I would encourage us to look at other options other than Comcast to get those economies of scale. Because this is the fire department doing its own thing, the police department doing its own thing, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And last time I checked, this is the 21st century. This is not. I don't think this is acceptable. I mean, we need the phone systems. We need the communication between our departments to maximize town service delivery yeah. efficiency. But we need to look into other options because this is a bunch of buildings getting their own internet. We are one town.
Have we negotiated with Comcast at all on this part, or is this what they just gave us?
This is what they gave us.
I would encourage go back to them and negotiate or ask what can you do better than this. I mean, they keep increasing your home service every year, and you talk to them, negotiate, and they give you some leeway on it. I don't see why they wouldn't do the same thing here.
Yeah, I can have additional discussions with them.
I would also research other voice over IP options. We don't have to stick with Comcast.
Other voice over IP options? So Crocker's providing the voice over IP.
But it sounds like Comcast is the one who's...
It needs to operate. It needs an internet connection to operate.
I get that, but... Well, I think you need to explore do a little bit more research because it's not, something's not jiving. I don't know what it is entirely, but.
Yeah. And I'll check back with Crocker too. Those are the two recommendations that Crocker gave to either for the MBI or for Comcast.
Okay. So. Neil Abram, I've been working with the town of Hatfield on similar issues because at work we're building a building in Hatfield. And they and Hadley, which I also worked with, have decided that the MBI fiber, which is great because it comes to places in the town, is not cost effective because the cost of renting service over the MBI fiber, so you're not paying for the fiber, but the cost of renting service over the fiber is prohibitively higher than going to Comcast. So Hadley, Hatfield are all hooked up over Comcast for the schools, for the town buildings. So what I'm going to suggest is that this is probably an issue for all of the small towns, which don't may not have a sufficient internet volume to justify some of these cheaper fiber-based connections, and instead are trapped that you're either going with Verizon at its possible service, or DirecTV and its possible service, or Comcast. You're going with the home providers for small towns because you can't get the high volume service that Amherst and Northampton are both getting by going directly with big fiber. So what I'm suggesting is that it might be worth talking to your counterparts at Hadley and Hatfield, because I think all three towns, maybe others, have the same issues and have maybe the same portfolio of providers, ranging over Crocker and Verizon and maybe AT&T, those you might be able to get things over phone service. They just have to choose what you're doing here, but your internet provider options are very few. And you either do the home level internet provider or you do something high volume, and there's just not enough data being pushed around by the town of Whately to justify looking for the high volume fiber.
Let me ask a more basic question. We seem to be set on voice over IP. I'm not even sure what that is. But what's the matter with a phone line? You know, the old-fashioned telephone system, like AT&T, Verizon, whatever. You dial numbers, you call up, you talk to somebody over a telephone wire. I don't know.
I would say from our experience, should you ask Fred's question, you ask them to bid for you and see what the bid options are.
But technically, from your point of view?
Technically, you can have more mobile connection if you're going over the internet for your phone line. Right? You're not tied to a wire that comes to your phone, which sits here.
Right.
Whatever device you have that is internet connected.
You go wireless.
You go wireless, so that the fire folks carrying their phones can receive fire station calls.
Okay.
And so mobile, you go with mobile devices, and you don't have to be in the office tied to the wire to get your phone.
Okay.
So it's like, it's a version of wireless, but you're pushing it out over the internet, which might have a wireless final.
But Comcast offers all them services today. To the homeowners, you can get all three.
Right, so that's why I said.
It's a different kettle of fish, though, between residential and commercial. I mean, it's just, well, different departments. You're dealing with different people.
The people pushing video around in their homes may well be pushing more data than the town.
Paul, you had a comment.
Are there any options with any of the buying groups that we're in, Franklin County or the...
Like FERCOG or whatever.
Yeah, FERCOG or anything.
I don't know.
What's Deerfield, Sunderland, Conway doing?
No idea.
I mean, that could be a way of getting us more volume and a better pricing. I don't know.
It just strikes me that they shouldn't be treating us as four separate customers within one town.
No.
And that
shouldn't.
Okay.
I tend to agree with you that those buildings are located so close to one another that they should be.
Even if they were miles apart, it's still separate. It's one bill.
It's a bill.
The question is, if you bought your own wire that connected the buildings all together and treated it as one big building like this is, could you then have one service point that served the complex rather than have Comcast serve three separate buildings? You might have to pay to string a wire and own that.
You know, I know that when I had a home office here and we had offices in Washington and Arizona, and I picked up my phone in my house and I hit an extension and I called Arizona. I dialed it 22. I don't even know what it was, but we were one customer. And we paid like one customer. Now, is it more than a customer who would pay, who would have one location? Sure, but it's not the same cost per facility, which it strikes me that this is, unless I'm reading something incorrect.
It was a per building charge.
It was a per building charge, right. And it was all the same.
But we paid separately at the town hall and the center school for Comcast.
I'll have a conversation.
Okay. All right.
Okay, you're still here if you want to get started on those.
Nicholas was going to come as well.
Well, then
he emailed me.
So he'll be here momentarily.
Yeah, I think so. He emailed me just for everybody.
So town emails is the next topic.
So right now, the town emails, there's around 27 different boards or committees that have emails within the town. There's a mix of public emails, Whately.org, there's @comcast.net, and there's private email accounts that are being used for the town. So it's a little bit problematic when we have private email accounts being used in terms of public records retention.
So when I email you, I'm using comcast.net.
I'm Whately.org.
Right.
At Whately.org. So we have three email addresses at Whately.org. We have 10 or 11 @comcast.net, and then we have a handful of boards and departments that are using private email.
And then you have people like the three of us who use our own personal emails.
Yes.
How did we come up with a Whately.org for the three? How was that ever decided? I don't see any rhyme or reason for them three, but.
I don't know. The Whately.org email addresses, I know, are at a different email host right now. So Rochin is hosting those three emails. Comcast is hosting the other emails. And then the other emails are a mix of Hotmail and Gmail and Yahoo.com accounts. So in terms of public record retention, it presents a problem because we don't really have any sort of method or way to back those up. Make sure those are retained. The other issue that we're having is the Rochin account. I think it's 4 gigabytes of space. That's nearing its limit. So we're going to have to buy more space if we're going to continue to use.
That's a server, though.
Rochin accounts. I believe they also do our email hosting.
Right, but that's on a server. Because on the cloud, you don't have that capacity issue.
Right, that's what he's going to get to.
What?
He's working his way up to that.
Okay, sorry.
So that's the issue, is that if we could consolidate all of the town's emails on one host at the cloud, we won't have the space limitations. Everybody could have a uniform, official, hopefully Whately.org email address.
Sounds good.
And they would have to use that for any official business.
They should.
They should.
No, they will have to if.
No home servers. That seems to be a problem.
Well, you email from home, but it's your.
As long as it isn't classified.
Right, I was going to make a joke, but I decided not to.
Well, or the other option for every employee to have a .org email to use from home. I mean, businesses do that all the time. You have a corporate email.
Right. Yeah.
It's easy to do.
Well, you do too. You know that. So, I mean, if you want to keep stuff public and recorded somewhere, I guess that's the way to go. Otherwise, my Comcast going to you can disappear anytime.
It can disappear.
Right.
So
it cuts the other way.
Well, yeah, the other way too.
If the town is sued and you do town business on your home email account, they'll seize your whole email account.
Right.
And you won't have access to it. They'll lock it up. And so do you want your home, it's like saying, do you want your home insurance tied up in for liability? This is, do you want your home email and all your private, truly private correspondence frozen by somebody suing the town, and their lawyer's going to come after every single email server you use.
And by the way, your email will no longer be private, even the ones that are supposed to be private.
That's right. That's my point. So everybody is safer doing all town business on town-level accounts. because then your private is private. But if you use your private email as a select board member and send a message to the town administrator at the town account, they know you used your home account, and their lawyer will want every single one of your emails just to check and see what other stuff you did on your home account. And I think you want out of that business. I urge you, protect yourselves by staying, doing all of your town correspondence on a town account.
I think that's something we should look at, then, for all our employees and elected officials, I guess, that do town business to have a town email account.
As soon as possible.
Right.
To be honest with you.
I mean, it's done by many other company corporations all have that.
Right. And it's okay. And because of space, it's got to go to the cloud. You're going to just be at capacity before you know it. And it's not any more expensive. And it's going to back everything up, and it saves you the problem because servers get old.
Yeah.
And then you have to replace the server. Why do you want to replace the server? Just go to the cloud.
Okay. So.
So I guess the question is, we can get sort of the basic service for about $50 per user, $50 cent fee, or we can go to something that's more expensive, like Microsoft 365 or Google Apps that has more bells and whistles.
Do we need more bells and whistles? I don't necessarily know what they are.
We do. And they have Google Apps for Government, they have Microsoft 365 for Government. It's more additional storage.
So how many people would be using?
The promise that we have right now is 27.
27 people in the town. Okay, times 50 a year. Is it a yearly rate?
So if we went with that company, that route.
Well, you're getting more than 27. That's only the departments or boards. You've got more than one person in each department.
That's one of the questions. I mean, does the select board want three separate emails? Do we want an official select board account?
No, it'd be separate emails.
Separate emails. I think otherwise it's a hassle.
It can't be
well, the person. It's like having the same phone number. I mean,
there's no way it's
for annual cost.
If you all use the same email, you would be having a private meeting offline outside
and that would be
public records problem. Because you'd be reading each other's emails, which you...
Who gave you $50 a pop?
Per year?
Yeah.
It was Coleman Communications. That was recommended by Virtual Town Hall. The company did the website. Google Apps is... Google Apps Government is $4 per month.
That seems cheaper.
Or $5 per month, and then $10 per month. Microsoft 365 was?
Four and eight.
One of them was 4 and 8, one of them was 5 and 10 per user. Per month.
All right, well, let's.
Can I connect you with somebody?
More?
Sure.
Just to have a conversation.
Yeah.
Maybe we can bring this to a vote next meeting.
Okay,
with some more information.
Okay, sure.
All right, well, I see some water people floating during our discussion there. And so maybe we can go backward to our 7:30 item here, Water Department District Merger and Water Department Staffing Plan. So, what is it? How are we doing with the merger? The idea is we're getting our systems together.
That sounds like me. We have not made much progress since I can't remember who was at those meetings with two engineers. George was, Mark Brunsky, maybe none of you guys were there? Yeah, well, we got ballpark prices for the engineering to connect the two systems, and we're trying to get ideas on how to connect the two systems, because an approach to take. And I think both the Water District and the Water Department both felt like this seems like an expensive way to go about it. So I've made a bunch of phone calls in the last few weeks pursuing this guy that George was working with, who sells the equipment that we may want. And he gave me some ballpark prices directly on the equipment that were sort of similar to total package, similar to the price of the engineering from the engineering company.
Okay.
So that's sort of like, that's...
And that ballpark figure was?
$80,000 to $90,000.
The engineering?
No, to install the to do the interconnect.
Okay.
Yeah.
But it was $80,000 to $90,000 to hire an engineer to give us options. Right.
Right.
Instead, if you pick the option without an engineer, it would be $80,000 to $90,000 just to do it. So
possibly,
maybe, yeah. If that's the right option.
Yeah.
But so it suggests that using the engineer will cost double.
Well, the idea of using an engineer is you get somebody who knows what they're doing to tell you what to do, right?
Right. Yes.
And if we don't need somebody to tell us what to do, because I don't know why, maybe we know what to do.
Well,
do we know what to do?
You know, I think you're going to have to hire an engineer because you got to get it okay from DEP.
Well, I would think so.
So at some point, they will expect an engineer to show up.
You're going to have to. But I don't think we need to spend $80,000 just for a study.
But that's what I'm hearing we need to do.
Why don't we have an RFP? It's an RFP and see what we get. Other than you got two firms already responded, right? That were wide range of cost and wide range of options, right?
So I think the thing is, I don't know. They were giving us...
You had two different options of the way to go about it, and the costs were from low to high, weren't they?
They were very similar. They were both putting in a pumping station.
Neither, by the center school or something.
Neither one was interested in the idea of a separate tank higher above the department's tank.
But why not issue another RFP to see who else is interested in helping us decide what to do?
Could we ask in that RFP for the bidders to provide whatever engineering certification of their solution is needed to pass with DEP? So rather than hiring a generic engineer working for us, it's like when you hire a contractor, you ask them to pull the permits.
Right.
Right? They get the electrical approved and the plumbing approved. Can we just have them bid that they'll take it through the permitting?
Well, it sounds like the question is, if we're building a house, we have the choice of hiring a contractor and having the contractor supply the plans and build it, or having an architect supply the plans and then hiring a contractor to build it, right? Is that what we're sort of looking at? So I like the contractor-built solution, given the aesthetics of a pump station probably are slight. And we don't need fancy pants analysis of how much pressure it takes to move a certain volume of water up a certain height.
Well, we might need some analysis of that, but I don't think that's going to be all that.
But that's pretty simple.
Yeah. And we have some of that already.
Okay.
Yeah.
We're talking gravity here. Pressure.
Anti-gravity, really.
Well, yes. Horsepower. Or whatever.
You know, does the water department feel the same way, that that's the way we should go? Hire the contractor rather than the architect?
First, you've got to figure out which direction you're going to go in. You have to know what size pump you want.
You know,
if you hire a contractor, he's not going to say, well, you need this or you need that.
He'll put it
in. Have to come to him and say, well, we need a 300-gallon-a-minute pump or a 50-gallon-a-minute pump.
Okay.
And then the contractor will give you a price on installing that pump, or the pumping station. Or
Fred Haynes, the salesperson, seemed to think that he could size the pumps.
Yeah, I don't think it's any big deal. They've been in business for 50 years.
Yeah.
Who's that?
What is it, Fluid?
So you got my email.
Engineered Fluid
Incorporated or Industries, or
I'm not in the Midwest somewhere. It's the people that put in our other pumping station in Westbrook.
Yeah,
that's how I got the name.
Okay.
So getting back to my question, do we need to hire a contractor or an architect?
I think you're going to have to probably get in touch with the engineer you use, or Berkshire Engineering, the people that we've been talking with, because the people that we were talking with said that they could handle something like that.
Because you'd have to pay an engineering fee to this company. And if you're over, what, $10,000, you have to advertise? Is that correct, Mary Helen and Brian? Over $10,000? You have to issue an RFP for, or is it 35 just for?
Engineering and architects is a little bit different.
Well, it's either 10 or.
Well, it might be easier if the Whately Water Department sold water to the district. The district put in their own pumping station. We put a meter on our main, and then it would be, you wouldn't have to go through a whole bunch of stuff as form, you know, making the district into the water department.
Okay, so if we did that, then the district would have to apportion or bill or collect, you know, to pay you guys back.
Yes.
Right, we so continue what meters. We're doing now.
You have meters now.
We have meters. We continue operating as a separate district, buying water from you instead of pumping it out of the ground.
So you're just a middle person between their billing and your residents?
Not really, no. We'd still be a public water supply, needing to have a contract, a certified operator operating our system. So one of my issues, and I don't know, you know, everyone I think in the group has got sort of different perspectives on this, but like right now we have a power outage at our pump house. We have no telemetry in there. We have no one gets a phone call saying you've got a problem. I have to wait till the neighbors call me to let me know.
The water pressure is low.
The water pressure is low, or notice it myself. I'm waiting for a call from the electric company. When they call, I have to leave to go meet them because we have like 18 PSI of water right now in the district. The district has a very small budget. About 3 years ago, we finally realized we had no liability insurance for a small nonprofit like ours. It's sort of a quasi-municipality. There was no cheap option. We ended up going with the same company, the same nonprofit that gets towns their insurance, the Mass Municipal Association.
Mayan.
Right. But it's almost a third of our budget right now is insurance. Right. Everyone working in the district, and you guys volunteer your time,
yeah.
But as commissioners, I volunteer kind of half my time.
Yeah.
If I've done some research, if I wasn't involved, and the district was hiring a contract operator, the rates would go up even higher for our water. I think it's very difficult to operate a tiny little water system.
And, oh, yeah?
And so that's my only, I like the simplicity of the idea of the pump station, we buy the water.
Yeah.
But I would so much prefer to see the two systems merged and have the institutional support of the town and the half-time employee and you know, as long as I'm here in Whately, I'm interested in being involved in the water, so. And I've got water licenses. I could be the backup operator. It seems like there's some kind of synergy in merging the two systems and the operations that doesn't really get achieved if we just put in a pumping station and we buy the water. Because then every issue that comes up,
it's still your issue.
It's still my issue, and it's kind of okay when it's still my issue. But
yeah.
Then once we're going to hire, you know, a contract operator from Worthington at $60 an hour.
Okay. So what's preventing us from going that route? It seems perfectly reasonable to me.
So which entity, so would the water district transfer its infrastructure,
yeah.
Its water mains and up to the meters and so forth, to the water department?
Right.
The water department takes on the cost of the connection,
sure.
And the pump. And needs bonds or some source of financing,
mm-hmm.
For the capital cost of the pump station to connect.
Right.
And then the department bills 40 more customers.
It could work that way.
And maybe then the district shuts down its wells and its pump house and pressure tank and all of that, because all of that service comes from the pressure in the main that's provided by the...
So it's a political financial issue.
Right. The town as a whole took on the water department. Right, everybody in the whole town took on the water.
Right. They're going to be costs.
Water department. But then is the town as a whole, West Whately, which gets no benefit, East Whately, which gets no new benefit.
And we've been down this path.
Just
West Whately
West Whately helped pay for the water department. Sure. But again, it's a question. You've got a whole lot of voters that would have to vote to spend more money to support water to 40 houses.
And then there would probably be a demand for those 40 houses to pay their individual hookup charges, just like a new house would.
And is that offset by providing the water mains, which...
I don't know.
Right, capital value in the infrastructure.
Well, just a quick point. The town, those individuals in the town who would not receive any of the benefits from this would also not pay for it, because that would all become under the enterprise fund, and you would become part of that, and you would pay for everything. It would bond through the town. The town would be the upfront payer, but in the end...
But the water users would pay back the bond.
That's right.
So it would be all of the water department clients that would pay it back.
Correct.
Not West Whately.
Right.
But East Whately would, because they're part of those who pay into the enterprise.
Right.
Your users are still going to pay their fair share using the water. It's not like everybody in town is paying for their water.
Well, everybody pays for their water, right? Individually.
Right, but everybody's going to pay for the infrastructure.
The infrastructure, right, but after that.
After that, everybody pays water.
Well, that's just like we did with the water department,
exactly.
Right? And the whole town paid for
the first stop.
Those people.
Yeah. All right.
But I would think that one of the things we would need initially is some assessment of what the water district has. I mean, what you actually own, what are the pipes, what are the connections, what are the meters, and if we're putting the department water through your system, is it capable of handling that increased pressure or volume or whatever?
Oh, if only it was increased pressure.
And if it isn't, what needs to be done? What's the cost to do that, I guess?
Well, that's part of the engineering. We're not going to hook everything up.
Yeah, so it's not just a matter of hooking up.
That's a very good point. But
it's not a matter of just hooking up one system to another and say, okay, we're fine. Now we got 40 more users on there.
That's
Can
right.
we handle it? Can a department handle that?
Are you, right you now, know? We're stretched very thin.
Yeah.
Paul?
This is a very small room. This is going to be a very short story. I've been here 61 years, okay? And I've been involved in the water since 1972, at all different levels. And we get into the same thing every time somebody either sits down and has a beer together, or you're having a picnic together, and everybody's doing this. It's time to get off our couch, stand up straight, and get this thing working as a team, and not a bunch of people banging their heads.
So, that's what I think we're heading for.
You will, and it's a good thing the room isn't any bigger, because we'd be talking about it next week. All I'm saying is, let's take and agree to move ahead. We've all got things that we would like to see accomplished, okay? We've got some people we don't ever want to talk to them. Forget it. You've got to have water, you've got a toilet, you wash your dishes.
Right.
Okay? And it isn't a matter of one part of town having the advantage of water and the other part of town having their own deep wells. Okay? It all comes down to this community has a value. It's a great community to live in. We have our disputes and bats like that. But push come to shove, when you're up against the corner, you'd be surprised how many people come running to help you.
Right. I mean, the case in point is, last time I checked, we just spent a little bit of cash on the redirection of the Mill River to save.
Well, the enterprise fund is getting taxed because the Mill River wants us to pay part of that.
But the town picked up part of that tax.
Yes, they did.
So we all did, to Paul's point, we were all in it together.
Yeah.
And we're going to have to be again. I mean, it's just the reality.
Well, there's no way the enterprise fund could pay for it. You know?
Right.
I would like us to see some milestones of what's going to happen when. and so we can keep abreast of this development so we can make sure that it comes to fruition. And I think the discussion has been helpful, and I think we're headed to a situation where we get this thing done, and everybody in the department now, the district is now part of the department, is one model. They pay for it, and then from then on, everybody's charged water use fees. That sounds like a reasonable arrangement to me. It's a win-win, I think. I mean, it's certainly a win for you guys because you get a more reliable water source and you get fewer headaches. And
I think the hookup fee, Paul, is going to be an issue that is going to have to be dealt with in terms of what makes the district different from someone who builds a new house and they pay their what's the hookup fee for the department?
$5,000.
That's going to be an issue that someone has to address.
So that might be offset in part by the value of the
by the asset. Yeah, it might be.
It might be offset in part by some reserve assets that the water district has that it might put in. And I'll say as a homeowner that we're paying, help me Nicholas, maybe twice as much per gallon.
I somehow drew a blank. Were we paying $6.50 per thousand gallons or $9? I think
nine. We're nine.
I think
so,
nine.
So we're nearly twice what the town is charging.
Yeah.
And would there be an agreement that these town users, these district users, keep paying at that rate, though it's not quite the same water, but keep paying at that rate for 3 years, 5 years,
yeah,
and then switch to the standard rate? And that is why I think the $5,000 kick in the teeth per household, we got some households that can't do it.
Right.
And so, some of them have wells, and they'll go off the grid and go to their private wells.
Yeah.
Or at least they'll threaten to. And others just can't afford it. You got some people who can't pay it. So
the payment method.
I think some alternative payment methods, asset value, cash reserves. I don't know whether the district could sell its wellhead pumps or other things, like sort of cash in its assets.
They're basically used homeowner's grade pumps. Okay. I don't
so,
think there
so would maybe you can't
anything,
get much.
But
you could look
there
at
is
the
six
whole
acres
package.
Of land
okay,
back there.
So we have to move on, but what I'd suggest is you all get your heads together, put your heads together, work out a plan of just what needs to be done, who's going to do it, what the costs involved, and how it's going to carry forward, and report back to us maybe at our next meeting or the meeting after that. But let's move this along and keep the momentum going that we have right now, because I think all I've heard is good ideas,
right.
And I think we're on the right track.
You know, we've got to put together, because the last time we talked about this was back in the center school basement.
We've got it.
Right, yes it was.
2 years ago, whatever it was.
Is there enough interest from the district? Is the district really interested in this, or is it just the two of you think this is a good idea and we'll go do it and promote it afterwards?
There's strong interest from the people who show up at our meetings.
Is there strong interest? Because that's a big factor. If there isn't, then we're always going to be fighting against your district people to get anything done.
Well, we have low pressure, low flow, single point of failure in Nicholas.
Right, that's
we've got all sorts of risks.
Right, but
so those who come,
those
who show up to vote the increased water rates from $6.50 to $9, that should draw everybody, and it didn't. It drew a third of
less.
The district.
Less.
So 12 households.
So are the other two thirds not interested then?
It certainly appears that way, and we put on the agenda 2 years running the idea of this proposed merger between the two the district and the department. Yeah. And people who have come have said, well, we don't like the idea of losing the district, but we understand these obstacles, and we think this does make the most sense.
So the people who come to the meetings have said,
how are you going to deal with the other two-thirds?
I think, isn't that always the case?
We'll have to have a meeting in which we declare now we're going to vote.
A binding vote. Right. What do your bylaws say about decision making? You're a nonprofit, right?
We are a quasi.
So you must have a procedure
for deciding.
We need
a quorum of ten people.
There you go.
Well, and we can vote.
This would be an awful expensive thing if you've got 10 people who are going to hook up and the other 30 that aren't.
Remember, you have the Whately Inn, you have the library.
I know, I don't care how you randomly pick your 10, but...
You have the cemetery.
It would be a $500,000 project for 10 people.
Okay, Paul, a good point. Paul, what?
For all of you with good memory, 1980, there were some people that weren't going to have any drinking water from the railroad tracks all the way to the Connecticut River, okay? They were too worried or upset about that, to worrying about who's getting more or who's getting less or who's going to get too much advantage. They were all unified in getting ahead and getting this thing going. They moved in tankers from the Army brought them in, and everybody was drinking bottled water out of the back of a tanker, and it was so much fun. And oh yeah, you could go up to the center school, and they had the faucet outside, and these women would come up with their milk bottles, plastic milk bottles, and fill water, those milk bottles, so that their kids could have clean drinking water.
From the water district.
We can kick this thing around and around and around. We're going to need a bigger room for more people.
All right.
I bet people are beating down the doors to buy homes and waiting that year.
Your point, I think, is if they don't want to be part of it, what is their option? To drill their own well?
That's not a challenge.
I don't know, but I don't see a lot of positive numbers being thrown out.
Finances, or people in the district?
Well, you don't seem to have a majority of commitment of your customers. You say, you know...
We don't have a proposition yet.
Well, then bring that to the table. And survey your people and bring that
back.
Right,
but I think it makes more sense to put together an arrangement
between
these two organizations that they can then bring.
Yeah.
They can't just throw something out that hasn't been negotiated between you.
We've thrown out the idea twice, and people have said, sounds good, we'd like to do it. The people who come to the meeting.
Okay. Well, I don't think the rest of people are going to be like, oh, we'll just drill a well instead of opening our tap.
You can't just drill a well. You're going to get a problem.
Yeah.
Okay. Number two, if you haven't got any water here or any water there, then they're going to start thinking positive. They're going to start working together. If you've got to hit them in the head, hit them in the head. Get the thing moving.
Yeah, I think what Nicholas
has to do is pursue your engineering company.
And this guy, Fred Haynes, about his pump station.
And then get back to us with a number, you know.
Sounds good.
Can we have you guys join us at our August 30th meeting with some information?
Sounds good. Which year, Paul?
So give us a month.
This year.
Last
2016.
Well, I'm getting old. I want to get
all right. So I think we're done with this discussion for tonight.
All right.
Thank you very much. Very stimulating. I'm looking forward to you all having reliable water, like I do.
Me too.
Thank you.
Water department.
Mine only costs $14.
You can just go up there and get a pail.
I can't even look at that water without
you want us to say.
Look
at their
staffing.
We're on the bridge. Doesn't it come
close to the bridge? Okay, so I think Keith is out there.
No, staffing. Paul, hold on.
Oh, sorry.
Thank you. All my people are leaving.
Oh, yes. Fire department. Water department staff. What?
Staffing.
Water department staffing plan.
Yeah, I've got a few things in the works. I don't have the information yet. I'm waiting for correspondence to come back.
Yes.
I talked to Brian today.
Yeah.
And we've worked on that. I've got a phone call coming back from a local guy, and I'm waiting for some information from Boston. So I can't give you a final update yet on how we're going to deal with that. They also got, or Mary Ellen got, some information from two water firms as to what it would cost.
Yeah.
So
there was also, if I recall, and I mentioned this to Brian this morning when we talked, is there any possibility of borrowing some other town's water person to come over and bill us by hour or per diem for what needs
well,
to be done?
Well, that's one possibility I'm working on, but South Deerfield just upped their main operator's salary to keep them because there is nobody.
There's nobody.
You just
can't get a backup primary.
Well, Howie, I don't know what's involved in this, but I mean, the person has to have a certain level of license to do a certain number of tasks. Mm-hmm. So the question is, what level is that license and how many tasks does that licensed person do, and could we find somebody with a license? You know, if it's just one or two tasks every month or week.
It doesn't go that way.
Okay.
I'll explain it to you.
Okay.
There's a D1, which means it's distribution, and the one correlates with...
As opposed to treatment or something.
Yeah, well, the one correlates with the number of customers you have.
Yeah.
So the district up street is a small one. That's a VSS one. This, the D1 would be ours. In that, you also have the T1 because we treat water.
Okay.
So the distribution is the piping and hydrants and all of that. What you need is 2 years experience working for distribution and 2 years for treatment. Ours being 20 hours a week, that means somebody would have to spend 4 years under a main
operator. For each one, and it's not, you can't treat the same 1 hour for T1 and D1. It's gonna be an hour for T1 and an hour for
D1. Separated.
It's separated hours.
So if you had 4 years working with us in there, you could split it up and say, all right, you've got the D1 and the T1. However, you can't, like he said, combine the two together.
Right.
So it's not something you can get overnight.
4,000 hours each.
Of experience, of on-the-job experience.
Yeah.
Working under somebody who is licensed,
right.
I imagine.
Okay. And to get somebody, one of the surveys they got was like $1,900 a week.
Could you back up a little? Maybe I missed something here. We have Wayne as the water superintendent. Is this because Wayne isn't qualified to do this, so we need to hire somebody else, or hire somebody in addition to Wayne, or what?
Well, we need to hire somebody in addition to Wayne to do the job, or we get rid of Wayne and get somebody that's full time, and you can't hire anybody, right?
Because there's no person.
And who is saying this? DEP is telling us this.
Yeah.
And what happens if we don't hire that person?
We're not in compliance.
We start paying a fine, probably.
Yeah, probably.
So how do all these other little towns deal with this? It seems like an awfully...
Well, what's happened, all the people who have had these jobs are now up in age and are retiring.
Right.
And once they retire, they don't want to come back and spend 20 hours a week or 40 hours a week. Obviously, there's no young people going out to be trained to be an operator now. And that's a problem in a lot of trades out there, whether it's welding or plumbing or even electricians.
Especially in small towns like
that. Oh, yeah, absolutely.
And if we hired or rehired Billy Smith to come back, would that
I've tried to bend his arm. Right now, he's not interested. But I can, you know, go back and see if I can resurface with the issue again and see if we can come up with something.
But if he worked for 2 years, and then would that give Wayne another?
Yeah, we give Wayne more hours.
We give him enough time, yeah. So he could,
Wayne's been
do it all.
Wayne's been part-time since 2012.
Yeah.
So what is he up to, a D1?
No, he's nothing. He's passed the tests, okay? The two tests, he has passed those. But you still have to have those hours, you know, of training.
So he has to work under someone.
His hours of work are 2,000 hours per.
And he's not.
They were.
So right now,
he was part time between 2012 and whenever Billy left.
Okay.
That was supervised.
He only worked when Bill
was not there. That's what I'm getting at.
I mean, that was only a couple weeks.
He never had duplication. So if Bill was hired back now, Wayne would be supervised by Bill.
Billy,
so
right. And that's what you need.
But
so basically, you need
hours.
It's not going to happen because he'd be back full time.
Well,
he retired.
Yeah.
And he would have to put in as many hours. He can't put that many hours in.
He can only do 18 hours a week.
Right. And he needs to work 20 something, 4 hours.
Well, I don't know. That's for
hours.
Him to
yeah,
decide.
20 hours a week.
He wants
secondary
to come back.
I mean, he doesn't He doesn't want to do it. He retired.
I know, but
right. That's yeah.
It. But his retirement is
got a business.
Impacted if he works more than 18 hours.
Right.
He loses out on his retirement.
But, you know, how long have we known about this? I mean, this isn't something that just came across the tape.
Well, we knew Bill was getting older, and he was going
to
retire. Well, once his wife passed away, he made the decision to retire. Right. That's basically what happened. Yeah, right. He's talked about it a number of years, and like everybody else, you know, you say things, and whether they come true or not is a different story. Back in October, when he did retire, that's when we hired Wayne. We had no one else. He took the tests, and maybe we're all at fault at some point for not really investigating, you know, further what you needed. At the time, when the tests were out, that was 4 years ago, all you did need to do was take the test. You didn't need to have any hours or anything. But then they changed the regulations where they stipulated that you needed, you know, the 2,000 hours for each one.
And is the guy that, and I spoke with the executive director of the plumbing group for DDP, the licensing board, for lack of a better term.
Yeah.
And, you know, we both readily agreed that with all the front page of the New York Times headlines with water issues in different parts of the country, the board is not going to be in any mood to be flexible with their regulations on this, because something happens and then it's front page in your time. Well, and I get that.
Yes. But, you know, that all of this aside, I think you're going to have a real good idea of what the penalties are coming downstream. And, you know, I think, because we can't throw somebody in place right away and there will be bills to pay because of it. You might want to go to town council and find out, you know, is there some way around this? How do we approach, you know, very often municipality issues, if you approach it early and start the conversation and get that two-way street before the ball drops.
Well, you know, it's almost like an unfunded mandate by the state. The DEP changing and making these regulations more stringent, it's putting towns in an untenuous situation.
But they do that all the time.
There's nobody that can do this work, and yet we have to have it done.
Well, that's what we're up against. Right. And like I said, $1,900 a week to hire somebody.
But that person doesn't even exist.
Well, yeah, they've got them. These companies.
Oh, the companies.
The companies. So $1,900 per week is the high one. The other one was, I think it was around $50 an hour.
Yeah, 50 or 75.
That was much more reasonable than
$50,000
a year. Yeah. We just about take that amount of money in, you know.
I would still think, well, like you said, Georgiana, people retire and they have second thoughts or get bored and want to do something. Still, rather than stay home, I would still approach Bill Smith. And at the same time, yeah, he's collecting retirement, but is there provisions for the state to suspend retirement if you go back to work? Or if he loses half or two-thirds, or sustains his years, I think that's also worth looking into to decide how it's affecting his retirement. There's a lot of different options on retirement funds, companies, and programs. It's more reasonable to hire Bill, and he's willing to do it, you know, for the 2 to 3 years.
Well, I will go back and speak to him and, you know, see what we can come up with.
Another option, you know, and I don't know how far afield the retiring operators are, but something to consider. Let's assume that Bill wants to stay retired for the most part, and let's say we need some. Well, let's say we need 24 hours a week. I'm just picking a number. Maybe we could find one person at 12 hours and another person at 12 hours to not impact their retirement, to be able to share the load.
Well, that's what I'm trying to do now with Billy and another guy, and see if I can get 10 and 10.
So then Wayne gets 20 hours. if he's working.
Under supervisor.
Yeah, under supervisor.
But then we're paying two people.
Oh, well, yeah, you have to. That's right.
Because he's not going to do a pro bono. He's not going to train for free.
But that's cheaper than the $50,000 to $100,000.
Right, but keep in mind, 8,000 hours. 4,000 for D1.
But they also said that he could get credit back to October already.
Okay, but still, I mean, you know, a full-time worker is 2,500 hours a year.
2,080.
That's full-time.
Yeah.
So it's a lot of years total. More than that.
I think, you know, we should also maybe have Kulik ask for, you know, intervene on our behalf to DEP and say, if we got an untenable situation here that we can't hire anybody to do this, and now we're going to be fined every day we don't do it. We got a guy who can do it, but it's going to take him 8 years or 4 years to get the necessary experience. That's ridiculous.
He probably doesn't even know.
And then, of course, you hire somebody like, let's say, Wayne finally gets it and then he moves.
Right.
But their option is going to be
$10,000 a year.
Deerfield.
But their option is going to be like Brian is saying, the $2,000 to $50 an hour hiring somebody is what they're going to say. Go hire somebody. You don't have anybody here. Well, that's the state's answer.
To protect the town, you think you should sign an employment agreement with whomever the individual is that is being groomed to take that position.
For a minimum of 6 years or whatever.
Yeah, once you're in, we will, you know, you have to stay here for X amount.
I don't know if you can do that.
We do that with anybody?
That's like imprisonment.
Yeah.
Indentured servants.
I didn't say to do it. I said,
you know, what may be possible to do is what if, I imagine Hatfield has a situation like this, right? Do they have a water system?
Yeah.
Okay.
But
so
they have someone there.
So.
Right. They're already full-time employees. Yeah. They don't work part-time.
Okay, fine, great. So would they have a full-time employee who does D and T?
Right.
The one person does both, I assume. So why don't we merge with Hatfield in terms of water inspection service?
We're already taking their water.
Whatever, I'm talking about using their guy who could do us and them, and we pay them for it. Meanwhile, Wayne could work under that person and get experience until we get our own person.
A 4-year contract or something.
Well, something like that. I mean, what the hell? How much does really going around and testing hydrants and whatever and testing water take 40 hours a week for a small town? I mean, come on, you could do that in a day. So I think that's a reasonable approach.
Has anybody talked to the COG about it?
I was going to tell the same thing. There's got to be other towns in Franklin County.
Maybe the COG. Conway, Ashfield.
I talked to Ashfield.
They don't have a public water supply problem.
It's the district, but the operator is the DSS license.
Okay, so the DSS won't work. It's got to be higher.
Because it's got to be a big enough system, whatever.
Right. He's actually working at other small towns who have small systems.
Let's call the COG and say, what do you got?
Call the COG and also I like my idea, actually. Mm-hmm.
Well, what does Northampton have in town? Do they have a facility?
Oh, yeah.
Is that an option? Ask one of them to help out? If they come to Whately every day to...
They're on Whately 10 times a day. Are you kidding me? They live at the restaurant.
They need to spend that amount of hours on Whately.
Yeah.
One of their junior people that just got another license or whatever it is.
I'm sure they probably have more than one person.
Of course they are.
So if Hatfield's full-time at 40 hours a week and they're required to put in 40 hours at Hatfield, they couldn't overlap and...
Yeah.
You know, you can do 40 in Hatfield, 20 in Whately.
Why couldn't they?
You can't double count the hours.
No, you wouldn't double count the hours, but they're just working 60 hours a week. Lots of people are willing to do that.
Yeah.
They're not getting paid overtime because it's a different employer, but...
If Northampton comes every day to check on something...
I mean, why would they care if we got that person for half the time, they got for half, we paid for half, they paid for half? They'd still get the same service because it doesn't take 20 hours a week. it sounds like, unless, I mean, he's probably doing other stuff, but that would cut their costs in half.
They need to meet their hour.
They probably
have to meet their hours. If they have to have a primary operator for 40 hours, they need to have a primary operator for 40 hours.
What do you mean? That's my point. What do you need a primary operator for 40 hours?
Mass DEP says so.
Right.
Well, that's ridiculous.
Well, but Paul, ridiculous maybe, but it's reality.
No, but for little towns, this is like, you know, Title V stuff. It's for Cape Cod. It's not for Whately, but we have to.
It's reality.
Yeah. That field would be the next license up to, it'd be D2, I think, 500 and up.
Okay, because they're a larger town.
Can we call the COG?
Yes.
And call other towns and say, what do you got? And not only just the COG, but call the Hampshire COG.
Yeah, I think, like, I'm still saying Northampton. Call Northampton, see what they have. Maybe there's somebody junior.
Well, I remember in the paper they were advertising for one themselves.
Oh, my God. Okay, so.
I'm telling you, they just don't exist.
So Brian's going to do some research. You're going to continue doing some research.
And I'll touch base with him.
And we'll see you again next meeting, or we'll hear from Brian about this.
Okay.
Thank you, George. All right, so we have Keith Cardwell in our midst.
One thing that I guess we can start passing around while we're in the talking discussion things, I've got Chapter 90 reimbursement.
I've already signed.
All set.
All perfect. All good. And we'll move right on. One of the things, Brian, did you give them the...
Yep, we got it all.
We've had a lot of discussion and things that are on the capital planning in regards to the highway department, and so I felt like it was time I needed to come in and discuss this with the board to see what the board's desires were to move forward with some of the issues present at the highway department. If I can read through this real quick if you want, or if you've all read it, I don't need to.
I've read it.
We can talk about the things. I mean, you know, the beginning, I just gave you a general synopsis of what the existing conditions were. Mm-hmm. My main thing that you know has been talked about recently is doing some things as far as painting goes. I do not know when the last time it was painted, but it is definitely quite a while ago. But in regards to that painting, things of that nature, the trim work around it, what do they call that? The soft fit and
fascia
boards, right? The behind the gutters, a lot of that's all original from 1960, and they need to be replaced. And so before you start doing any painting, like, the gutters got to come off. Consequently, also, if you're going to put the fascia boards on, you got to do something with the drip edge, and all that should be done in conjunction with when you redo your roof. So those are the things that we've got to make a decision. Do we want to start putting money into this building, or do we want to also look at it for more of the long-term aspect of as to whether the building is structurally sound to move forward with these things. There's also been the discussion by some people that they'd like to see solar on that building. So it does have a perfect southerly face on the one half of it, so it would make sense that after it got shingled.
Structurally, it would never.
Structurally, I don't know.
I wish it would, but there's no way.
Those are the things, right? I just don't know. As I gave you also a copy of the report that we got from Theirs Three Associates after we had, and even after they came, Drew Quinlan, who wrote this up, he came probably two or three times, and he came once with a structural engineer, and Jacob Smith was his name. And after he came and looked at it, he got back to me and he says, you know what, I'm not even going to charge you for it. So that $1,200 is still sitting there. In fact, Mary Ellen and I had talked about it. And the language of it is probably got to, the way the article was written, has got to go back to the general fund. But I didn't know if that could possibly be used towards doing a few more, maybe some more analysis on our own. The things that I don't know is areas where the building is starting to show settling and the bricks are starting to, you know, you see the cracks. Maybe we need to do some digging down and see what the blocks below grade are looking like. Those are the things that I don't know. And this is where it's beyond my, you know, from a building aspect, or maybe we need to bring someone in that is familiar, you know, building-wise and say, all right, what can we do with this building? Is it even worth saving?
By reading between the lines of Thayer Street Associates, they would say no, it's not worth saving.
Well, they were saying no as far as trying to put more load on it.
I get that, but...
There was definitely, the one thing they did determine is there was no, and again, I don't know the terminology, but there's no structuralness in the block itself. So by going higher, it was just creating more of a wind shear. And the building code, there had to be cords or something like that where it actually come down through the block, cinder blocks, tying those walls together so they don't have the tendency of wanting to just blow over under a high wind load.
Their report was just on, yeah, like
I'm said, looking at the feasibility. Would it be feasible to raise the roof?
Yeah. Wait, I get that, but
that part was not feasible. Now, is it feasible to, are we going to reshingle the building? Can it tolerate the weight of solar? Those are the things no one's addressed that. You're right, maybe Thayer Street is correct in saying that it wouldn't, but they didn't specifically look at it from that aspect.
No, I get that. I'm projecting.
Even if you don't do solar, I mean, that's an extra. You got to decide whether the building itself is worth, I guess, saving and repairing what needs to be done. And yeah, it's stood since, what, 67? Whenever
1960s.
You know, it's going to be, if you don't save it and maintain it, it's a tremendous cost to do something different. And I guess I don't see that as even an option right now. I think we need to maintain what we can on the building. Doing something as far as another building or something different than maintaining what we have, whether that's moving somewhere else or a new building or whatever. I guess I don't see that as an option in the near future.
Yeah, I would think that even with the deficiencies that the building has, that we could still go ahead and reshingle it. Again, the building has two layers of shingles on it, the original from 60, mm-hmm. and then it was shingled in 1988 the second time. So it would have to be stripped off.
Yeah.
And at that point in time, we could have shingles reshingled. But the other things that are starting to show on it, as I said, all the sagging and things of that nature that have taken place in the last few years and cracking that.
Keith, when I was over there the other day, we talked about putting together a punch list. Did you start that punch list or?
Well, yeah, I did to a certain extent, but I. And some of that's what's on here is I need to follow up. I mean, there's a lot of more smaller things.
Right.
But the bigger picture is, right off the bat, is, again, before I can paint it.
I just think we have a whole picture of everything that needs to be done to that building. Then we can say, okay, and then we can ballpark costs for everything that needs to be done to that building, then yes, there are going to be mm-hmm. priority one, priority two, priority three in terms of what needs to be done first, second, and third in terms of structural integrity, but also in terms of what needs to be done first, second, and third, because that's what that's the order of business. But I just think that we need a laundry list of things so we know what we're looking at, because otherwise we're going to do two or three things and then we're going to have two or three more things, and it just... I'm not comfortable having that snow.
Yeah, I understand what you're saying. Try to get the complete picture.
I hate to say this, but it seems to me like this is another case where we might need a consulting engineer.
I was just going to say,
well, like Dave Leland or somebody who's done structural stuff. I know somebody in Springfield, but they would, or Helwig maybe, would come up and say, okay, here's what we're thinking about doing with this building or would like to do. What do we have to do to make this happen? Or what can we do? Like if we want to put solar on the roof, is it structurally able to support it? Which, you know, it may be with the addition of some sort of laminated beams across the their joists, right. Their right trusses holding
trusses
up the roof, right?
They're all trusses. Right.
So, you know, it could be we could diffuse that load by putting in a central beam that wouldn't take up too much headroom, take that down with two pilasters on either side to support it, and that might stabilize the roof for 20, 30 years, which is how long the solar system will last. And you know, the solar will also make the roof last longer.
I feel, since I can certainly come up with some more things from the punch list side, but again, with not being a building, I don't want to be the one that goes and makes the punch list and then finds out that I missed something because I'm not.
No, I get that, but we have people in town who
we could ask
and just say, hey, will you walk through this? Because I really do think we're remiss in not having that.
If there's
full
picture. No, building people, I could certainly.
I don't know who they are, but I'm sure they exist. You know.
But I think you're saying the roof would go, you got into a 2019, if you go solar, then fine. I guess I wouldn't focus on fixing a building just to put solar on there.
It's got to be fixed anyway.
I know, and I think there's some things that can be done, and what I've seen and heard from you and others is the structure itself, the blocks, the foundation is settling. Maybe you should be. And that's what I think an architect or a consultant is going to tell you. Yeah, your foundation is poor condition, so you need to put new foundations in. I think we already know that, Keith. Okay. My suggestion, go to a contractor that does that kind of work, whether it's a mason or a structural engineer or whatever these people are called, and ask them, what's it cost to fix the foundations of this building?
I don't think they can give me that without same kind of things we're going through with the town hall. You're going to have to get into it.
Well, then they would tell you. They would tell you what they need to do, and if they want to charge $8,000 to dig some holes to figure out what's there and what needs to be done, I think you know what needs to be done to fix the building. I don't think you need to hire somebody to give you a laundry list of 18 items that somebody is going to decide needs to be done, and then you're going to hire the contractor anyway to do it.
Well, I don't know the building codes.
So. Well, supposedly, say a mason contractor would know that. And if you only got 2-foot footings, maybe he's going to tell you you need to go down 4 feet. Well, that's what needs to be done.
I don't think anyone suggested that we're going to go off and hire someone to tell Keith what needs to be done. I'm suggesting that we have talent in this town who also know building code, who know structural issues, who can help Keith put together a list of what to do. Because I know I don't want to go to town meeting in 2017 and say, we have to fix these two or three things. And then in 2018, we have to fix these two or three things or four things. Then in 2019, these two or three.
Right.
Because people at some point are going to say, wait a second.
Don't
you guys have your junk together?
I think Keith is aware of that and wants that to be done. And so the question is, do we find somebody who wants to volunteer? They happen to be a structural engineer and a foundation expert and know all this stuff, and they can go over there and give you a great appraisal. Or do we have to actually, you know, have somebody and pay them for an engineering analysis, which, to my mind, I would feel more comfortable with, as opposed to having some resident come over there and look at stuff and say, well, you know, you probably got to do this and that and this and that. Maybe yeah, maybe no, I don't know. I mean, so buildings crack, that doesn't mean necessarily there's some settlement.
I just don't want to be in a position where we start down the road and then we found out we missed something.
That's right.
So that's fine. But
then we're
going to
look like
egg
on our face too.
I don't see the need to hire somebody to tell us that list. I think Keith is qualified to do that. You knew you needed to fix the electrical and you're working on that. You didn't need somebody to tell you that, did you?
The lighting, but I don't know I don't know every aspect of building code, so that...
But you know some things that are obvious that need to be done,
but
corrected.
But obvious isn't necessarily exhaustive.
Fred, but...
Well, it's not Fred.
A
consultant is going to give you a whole laundry list, and then you still got to decide what needs to be done. What's priority? Who's going to decide that? Keith is going to decide that. What is a priority? It's his building. He should know what needs to be fixed.
You go to a consultant in a case like this, like you go to a doctor if you have certain symptoms. You want somebody who knows what the symptoms might be or might not be, and how serious they are, to be able to say, look, I prescribed this and that for you, and that's my diagnosis. But, you know, you could go to somebody who's really, you know, knows how to take care of themselves and is in great shape and say, oh, what's the matter with me? And they'll say, well, you know, you should run more and you should eat this and that. Who knows? You may have some terminal disease.
Could the same structural guy we just used, we still have $1,200.
Hell week.
No.
They're associates.
Well, they're in Deerfield.
Fair Street?
Yeah.
Are they structural people?
The language on the article clearly states that it's to...
pay for an estimate to decide...
To raise the roof.
It's very specific to that one point.
But forget the 1,200. Could we just contract with this guy? He's a good guy. He's right in the neighborhood. Keith can dig some foundation holes. Just let him take a look. He's going to say, hey, your blocks are shot or not. You know, whatever. I mean, it's a good start. Not much money. We can dig the holes.
Yeah.
Well, that's kind of what I'm saying. You address the problems that you know today, whether you get that guy
start at the bottom and go up. I wouldn't start at the top and go down.
We can do that, but we can also...
We can make the list right now.
We can't make the list right now. We're not going to make the list right now.
Keith knows it in his
seat.
We're not making the list right now. But I'm okay with it. If this guy's competent, I'm okay with that.
There's the best.
Are they
do good work? I don't disagree with that.
Okay, and they do commercial fires and all that.
Yeah, they did a police station.
That's who did the police station.
Well, okay, that's all right. Fine.
So fine.
I just want somebody we can say.
Let me give Drew Quinlan, or I'll talk to the owner actually and start.
He's on vacation until Friday.
Oh, all right. Well,
just saying.
Anyways, I will contact, how about this? Let me contact Ashley Associates and talk to them and say, all right, you know, we want to follow up on a few other things and see if they can get them to come back and work with them a little bit.
Okay, good. Because we just want to know what we can do with this building, what makes sense and what doesn't.
I think we also have a building maintenance budget.
Well, we have a capital stabilization
budget
fund that should be funded annually, but we went down that road before, but people thought the select board would create a slush fund.
No way, I thought we got you that.
What's that?
I thought we got that.
No.
We didn't get it?
We haven't changed that. We got to change it.
Okay.
Right, Mr. Finance Chair?
That's absolutely true.
John.
Can we move along here?
Just a couple other things I wanted to just inform you on. My new truck has been ordered. It's probably in the vicinity of 2 months out before it'll be in, and then needs to be built. So definitely we'll have it before winter. The other thing is in regards to getting back to the building with the electrical work. I talked to Brian. Brian, finally, we've got the prevailing wages from the state. So I've also asked Brian when he has time, the two of us sit down so we can prepare the RFQ. Sure. And we'll get that out and get that rolling. And then lastly, one of the things that I've also spoken to Brian, and I feel the best thing is almost, in a sense, starting over, because he wasn't involved in it, and that is in the driveway permits that you were involved in, and John Robleski, because there's a lot of that's something that I want to get that wrapped up. So those are the few things that I just wanted to...
So you don't think the work that was done prior to this on the driveway permits is usable?
Yeah, I mean, I don't think we're that far off, but I think we just need to...
We've come to final resolution and everything, so...
Just sort of need to wrap it up.
Okay. That's on our priority list.
When Brian and I looked at the notes that Mark left, it's not very, you know, it's not very clear as to... You couldn't take it and say, okay, this is what needs to be done.
Have you talked to Mark at all about this?
No, we just met.
I think the four of us need to meet again and decide whether what we have is enough.
That's what I'm saying. I think real quickly we could easily wrap it up. Some of the changes that I've already done working with the building inspector in regards to heat, when I did talk to him, he suggested that when I do my initial sign-off, I put down that they need to contact me before the CO is issued. So he said that would probably work. However, I haven't had a house completed since we started doing that.
Yeah. You know, John's disagreeing.
Well, see, John's I don't sign off on because it's
private
not
way.
It's a private and way. That's another one of those things that we discussed a little bit. It's not. I don't really have any jurisdiction on it. It's not a town.
The roads there are private ways.
It's all private.
Yeah. Until they're accepted. Wait, so what fills it out?
They get accepted.
Yeah.
You have to make the assumption they are, but,
right.
You know, again, it's...
So why don't you send us what the latest version you have, and then we can set up a meeting.
Okay.
And then you get the FERCOG sign oversight committee representative appointment.
Yep.
I wasn't aware of that.
What is the sign oversight
committee? Street signs?
Yeah, basically...
There's a committee?
There's actual... I've been to many of the meetings on it. It's actually going to be a great program. The sign equipment has been purchased by Franklin County. We got grants to do it. It's town of Greenfield, or the city of Greenfield is the holder of the equipment, and we're going to be able to get signs made at a fraction of the cost.
They had signed the agreement.
Right. We already have the agreement, and now this is to be... does every town have to have a representative?
Yeah.
Okay.
And you had offered to be the representative.
Yep.
For leave.
I can't think of a better person.
It's fine with me.
This only talks about, well, the example is a guide sign. Is this applied to all signs, regulatory and
street signs?
Anything in the MUTC.
MUTC, okay.
But this is replacement as needed, not replacement just because we have a...
Replacement as needed.
As needed, right. And who decides that as needed? We do or they do?
Me, Tom Whately. They don't come in tell us to replace signs.
Okay, I didn't know whether by joining this they all of a sudden had that authority to.
No.
So if you want to
go all year long and not purchase a single sign.
Speaking of signs, I would request a sign telling people Poplar Hill goes this way, Conway goes that way. There's a sign that's in Conway, Williamsburg, but it's an old sign right at the corner.
Right. One of the things that I be on my top priority when this program gets going is to continue with replacing the street signs. We did a lot of the main roads, like River Road, Christian Lane.
Sure.
With the new the manual on uniform traffic control devices would require 9-inch signs. Now you can't use any of the 6-inch. So a lot of signs that we had out there, like in West Whately, those are non-compliant. I need to replace those.
We think they're very quaint, though.
They're quaint to the point of being illegible and rusted out.
They will be high visibility. They'll all be...
Well, I don't even...
Next he's going to want bridges on Williamsburg Road.
No, exactly. I'm not going to comment on that.
These West Whately.
So, okay. I just want people to know what road they're on.
Okay.
Yeah. Your people would make the signs?
What they're going to do is try to train some people now. Not every single town is probably going to necessarily have a... It really comes down to how many you make, and that was some of the things that they're still trying to work out.
Yeah, that's pro.
So who would do that for our town?
I'm not sure. I could, if I wanted to have somebody trained, we could, but it was also discussed that, you know, maybe on a regular basis, we give a list to like Greenfield and like on a rainy day or something when they can maybe have their manpower would do it. And that was what the $10, there was a flat fee of
ad. Assigned fee paid to Greenfield, yeah.
Right.
Okay.
So.
All right, Keith is our guy.
Okay, could I just ask?
I can't do that.
Keith, it's your switch to the fire department. Since you're a member of the fire department, what's the latest with our truck here?
And talking with John, I don't know if he went today. I talked to him on Monday, and he said he might be going today down there to discuss things with the service manager. All I can tell you is after we did our initial training with them, and they had told us to make a punch list of the issues that we had with the truck, and as soon as they got done with the training, if there was any more issues that came about during the training, which there was, the phone system was plugged up, that they would address it. The very next day, they came and got the truck, and I do not know where it stands exactly, what's been done, I don't know, other than you'd have to check with John.
And this is in Rhode Island?
No.
Back to where?
Bulldog fire apparatuses, they're, it's just one like exit south on 495.
I think it's Wakefield?
No, it's down.
495 south of the pike?
Yeah.
So,
Hopedale, may, or it's a small.
Hopedale would be on the rail.
Okay, well.
Okay, so you have no idea or when to expect it back?
No.
Did we get our hose and all that we needed?
Recently there's been a lot of boxes that have come in since they took the truck out. I don't know if everything.
We should have John in here ask these questions rather than Keith.
I don't know if everything.
John would know and Keith, you know.
Right. I think we've exhausted our agenda too. If not our.
What about Egypt Road?
Audience. Paul.
Public
comments. A while back.
Yeah, you were late.
Up front, little overview sketch of where we are with this building, Skems, the school.
Okay.
I've been kind of out of the loop for a while.
Ryan, do you want to fill us in on what you know?
There was a Zoom meeting last week.
Somebody knows.
We are in the process of getting ballpark estimates for subcontractor bids on a design that was put together for the Skems area over here using the old dimensions, not the dimensions that were used in response to the RFP that the town of Deerfield put out. We will have those prices. And again, they're not official estimates, but they're just ballpark estimates. But they're usually pretty good. We will then have a discussion with amongst the BOO as to how we want to proceed. But we now have design plans, and there is a building committee of Skems to discuss how this is going to look.
Mm-hmm.
All cards on the table, there is still an element in Deerfield that is looking for an alternative option. What that looks like and whether it can accommodate three ambulances, I'm hard pressed to believe they're going to find a turnkey building with three or four bays. But just so people know that there's that element that is still looking into those options, they're trying to find free buildings somewhere.
And how long are they gonna keep this up?
They don't have the choice. The Skems Board of Oversight, once we have these ballpark estimates, will then decide whether and when we take this to the three
towns.
All right. It still has to go on town floor?
It has to go on
town. Who's providing, we're doing these estimates?
I'm in the process of looking into, I'm using Fair Street, that's how I knew that.
So we're hiring someone
on vacation.
We're hiring somebody?
No, we're not hiring anyone. They're ballpark estimates from people who know
electrical, HVAC, cement, whatever other size.
At the point of getting ballpark estimates is so Boo can decide what alternative makes the most sense for them. But then they have to convince, if they pick alternative A, then Deerfield, Sunderland, Whately have to meet town meeting
and to vote for A. Meetings. Or but those can be special town.
Does the Deerfield Select Board have to approve it first?
The Deerfield, not necessarily, but the Deerfield Select Board are all members of the Board of Oversight.
No, I know that. So, they're also the fiscal agent.
They are. But yes, so they would have to. But again, the Board of Oversight, if they make a recommendation to the town of Deerfield, the town of Deerfield not adhering to a Board of Oversight recommendation would be an issue.
Did they already do that, though?
No.
Did Boo already recommend to Deerfield?
The Board of Oversight in its former population, for lack of a better term, and I butchered that sentence, recommended that they enter into negotiations with the town of Whately and anyone else who chooses. It was a mistake. We're trying to rectify that mistake with the new.
And that mistake meant that Deerfield could then go out on their own.
Not Deerfield, but people in Deerfield would have license.
Concerned citizens.
Concerned citizens, yes.
Mm-hmm. So what's the new configuration?
Well, there's me.
No, I mean, not the committee, the new for the office space.
It was put together. It's the same footprint, but in order to go to different subs like cement, etc., you need to know where the walls are. And so you go to a plumber. Okay, this is where the bathrooms are going to be. This is where the showers are and that kind of thing. So then they can look at it and say that's going to cost you $5. This is going to cost you $10.
Well, didn't we have some of that before?
No, we just had the footprint. We did not have. We never had walls. We never had
rooms.
Didn't HAI give us?
No.
Give us that?
Never did.
How did they come up with the 200 to 300,000 figure?
Estimate. I think that's where we're going to be. I think we're going to be in the $300,000 range.
Okay.
All right. So.
Okay. So it's moving. Mm-hmm. Is it moving as quickly as we would all like? Perhaps not, but it's moving.
Not even and perhaps.
They
would have been in there a year ago.
I have every faith that it's going to happen. Sometimes good things take time.
I think ultimately, though, the concern, in the general public's eyes, is that one of the caveats for them coming here and the pricing that we gave them was the fact that they wanted to improve the service, and that kind of pricing allowed them to improve the healthcare delivery service that they were bringing to these towns, going from EMTs to paramedics. If they move to a building where the cost is prohibitive for them to do that, in essence, what you have is you've got a bunch of local yokels over there affecting the healthcare delivery of everybody in these towns.
And Paul, you have to trust me that I'm working very hard to make sure that doesn't happen.
This is aggravating.
We could appoint you to the Boo also, right? We need more members. We could all be on the Boo.
No. The Boo is full right now.
Full.
The Boo is full.
And the Boo is full.
Until we pass.
How did they get all their select board members on it?
They have three. They have two voting members and then a third non-voting member because
that's right. They're the fiscal agent.
They're
special.
But it's not a voting member.
All right.
How does this impact what the school is looking at?
I don't know. That's not my.
I was told the school's gone.
The school does not sound like it wants to be.
But we haven't heard officially from the school.
I think lack of hearing is official.
I ran into one of their members and they said they're meeting on what's the next committee? August 3rd, I think.
August 4th
mm-hmm. to make a final decision whether this is acceptable or Frontier has enough space, and then to decide on, I guess, cost or whatever. They're hoping to make a decision on that date.
So. And if it works for us, great. If not, that's the way it goes.
Thank you.
Well, all right. Any other comments, items?
Can we just set a next meeting date? Because the one we had was August 9th, and it doesn't appear we're going to have a quorum that day.
Really?
I can't think of it.
I'll make it.
You said you couldn't.
No, the 30th.
Ninth.
The ninth I can make. The ninth I'm out. I'm on my vacation. Right, I'm sorry.
I thought you couldn't do anything.
Right, I can't go to him that week.
At all that week.
At all that week.
So the 16th would be the following Tuesday.
Fine by me.
Yeah, it's fine with me.
Sure.
And then I would like to have us at least keep open the possibility of moving the 30th to the 29th. I don't know that I'll need it yet, but I may. Because that does not work for you. If it doesn't work for you guys, I mean, I don't have to be here.
I'm teaching that day at school.
On the 29th.
On the 29th, yeah. Okay. But, you know, I could still make it back from New Hampshire. I get out at 6. Take me an hour and 15 minutes.
Okay.
So we're doing this 16th
hour. I mean, you guys should just stick with the plan, and if I can make it, great. If not, fine. That's the way it goes.
Gee, that's a pretty high-tech system, you know.
Yeah, can't get the whole...
Okay, motion to adjourn.
Yes, second, let's go. We're done.